Audible Inc. presents Spend Shift, How the Post-Crisis Values Revolution is Changing the Way We Buy, Sell, and Live. Written by John Gerzema and Michael D'Antonio. Foreword by Philip Kotler. Narrated by Ray Chase. Foreword. In my book, Chaotics, I explain a new world where businesses must adapt to a new economic age. We have entered an era when increased turbulence is a fact of business life. Today's managers must operate within an environment of endless volatility. The new reality is a world of continuous and at times crushing change. The lessons for marketers are sobering. Brand equity changes in compressed periods of time. Competitive disruption happens without warning. And consumers are increasingly powerful and unpredictable. For those prone to celebrating a leadership position or a competitive market advantage, commoditization lies just around the hairpin corner. In a post-crisis world, with the specter of a jobless recovery and more limited purchasing power, consumers themselves have experienced chaotics. Yet there is new, hopeful data to suggest that people are redefining their lives and reviving core values, things like hard work, thrift, fairness, and honesty. They are separating want from need and discriminating more carefully both in product and brand choice. Consumers are buying into brands with meaning, brands with integrity, social responsibility, and sustainability at their core. This values-led consumerism is not a small, isolated target market. Over half the U.S. population is now embracing these values shifts. They are seeking better instead of more, virtue instead of hype, and experiences over promises. The post-crisis consumer, already highly marketing savvy and armed with the leveling powers of social connection and critique, is now an even more potent and unpredictable force in the marketplace. People are looking for value and values. I came upon these ideas when John Gerzema, Guy Kawasaki, and I were speaking at a marketing conference in Las Vegas in the fall of 2009. Over breakfast, we talked about the implications for consumer behavior in the economic recovery. John's research, based upon the world's largest database, Brand Asset Valuator, gave credible evidence that consumers were shifting their values and their spending accordingly, and many prescient businesses had already adjusted to the new consumer mentality. But Gerzema wasn't predicting a wholesale era of endless frugality and a consumer in retreat. Rather, his data demonstrated that brands, in a world devoid of trust, were increasingly more important. And companies could find new forms of competitive advantage by understanding and sharing in the values that were becoming more important to consumers, such as ethics, community, empathy, and accountability. The lessons in this book are useful to anyone examining their business strategy after the crisis. They explain the new psyche and value shifts that are influencing the spending habits of the American consumer. Along with his partner, Michael D'Antonio, a Pulitzer Prize-winning writer and reporter, Gerzema details exemplary strategies of multinationals and small businesses alike. He shares the methods of adaptation among large Fortune 500 companies, while exposing us to new startups who are capitalizing on the values shifts in this new market landscape. While the data is extensive and thorough, perhaps even more compelling are the stories the authors have gleaned from their travels across America. Through these accounts, Gerzema and D'Antonio help us understand the lasting impact of the crisis on middle-class families, small business owners, entrepreneurs, and CEOs. They also help us understand the strategies people are already using to move forward. As voting patterns define the societal mood, consumption patterns do the same. How we spend our money and our time, as well as our energy and efforts, reveals how a value shift is, indeed, reshaping capitalism. Spend Shift offers insights into how our lives are changing after the Great Recession. It explains a new consumer movement that you should understand regardless of whom you define as your target market. And it carries forward my lessons from Chaotics, offering managers, marketers, and entrepreneurs insights into how to understand and cater to the consumer of the post-crisis world. Philip Kotler, S.C. Johnson Distinguished Professor of International Marketing, Kellogg School of Management, Northwestern University. Introduction. Numbers and Their Meaning. Kansas City, Missouri. The typical evening seminar crowd at the Nelson Atkins Museum in Kansas City, Missouri, could hardly be described as ragingly radical. The city lies smack in the middle of the conservative heartland, and the museum is a traditional limestone landmark that draws heavy support from old money families. Few institutions would seem more connected to the forces of stability and propriety. Until a few years ago, it was still the site of the annual Jewel Ball, where debutantes paraded for high society. About a month before our appearance, the Atkins had hosted Edgar Bronfman, one of the richest businessmen in the world. A few weeks later would come a former president of the World Bank, James Wolfensohn. Sandwiched between these pillars of the corporate establishment, we were worried about how our message, that America was undergoing a radical but ultimately positive shift in consumer values, would play in a state where the official motto, "Show me," promises a cold welcome to know-it-all outsiders. As it turned out, a few factors had prepared the crowd to hear us. First and foremost was the condition of the economy in the summer of 2009. With unemployment racing toward double digits and business activity declining, America was approaching the low point of the worst business crisis since the 1930s. Dubbed the Great Recession, this downturn had shattered public confidence in the usual sources of wisdom, including financiers, economists, and politicians. To be sure, the crisis had made lots of people angry and resentful, but the shared suffering had broken down some of the barriers that can separate us and made many people more eager to hear fresh ideas, especially if they were based on solid information. The analysis we brought to KC was built on the world's largest reservoir of data about consumer attitudes, preferences, and values. Based on 17 years of quarterly data involving more than 1.2 million people, this wealth of information has been gathered by the international marketing and communications company Young and Rubicam, where it is overseen by John Gerzema. One of the two authors of this book, John manages this ongoing study, which is called Brand Asset Valuator, as Young and Rubicam's chief insights officer. Young and Rubicam has invested over $130 million in the data, which goes back to 1993. In all, he has spent 25 years studying and analyzing how people behave in the marketplace. His co-author, Michael D'Antonio, is a writer with long experience in addressing social and economic trends. Brand Asset Valuator holds data on more than 40,000 brands in more than 50 countries. And every quarter it is supplemented with new results on purchasing and social attitudes from 17,000 respondents in America alone. This information helps us understand what people prize in a material sense and how that changes over time. More important, as people reveal their preferences about products and companies, Brand Asset Valuator opens a window on their inner drives, motivations, and values in ways that other models cannot. Brand Asset Valuator reflects the way people shop in the real world, meaning we can access a given company or brand against thousands of others in the marketplace on more than 80 metrics, which include everything from awareness and relevance to social reputation, quality of service, or level of trust. We can quantify which brands people think are different, authentic, more innovative, or more responsible. And because Brand Asset Valuator is tied to financial metrics, we can detail correlations to pricing power, consumer loyalty, usage, and preference, and trace the linkage between brand performance, financial earnings, and stock price. The Brand Asset Valuator consumer panel also allows us to peer into their lives to understand everything from their political affiliations to their values, attitudes, and behaviors. Most important, it gives us leading indicators of marketplace change, often far before the complete picture emerges in data such as market share and consumer sales. The challenge for the folks in Kansas City, or at least the challenge we expected, would be in the interpretation of the numbers. However, we felt the evidence was incontrovertible. The numbers said that the consumerism we have known for nearly 30 years, the main force behind the American economy, is finally dead. Say goodbye to all the easy signs of wealth we knew from the recent past, McMansions, SUVs, and recreational shopping. Say hello to a lifestyle more focused on community, connection, quality, and creativity. In the long run, all this change will yield a wonderful renaissance of hope and purpose in our lives as individuals and in the life of our country. But in the short term, the process is going to challenge us all to be brave, resourceful, and energetic. Knowing that no amount of sugarcoating would influence our audience, John decided on a first-the-bad-news approach. After being introduced, he walked out onto the stage, waited for the polite applause, and began by saying, $13 trillion worth of wealth has evaporated over the last 2 years. It's a shocking number, equal to almost 15% of America's net worth, and roughly the same as an entire year's gross domestic product. For individuals, the losses associated with the Great Recession, which started at the close of 2007, had been much less abstract. Millions of people were laid off from their jobs, saw their investment and retirement funds disappear, and lost nearly a third of the equity in their homes. The most unfortunate suffered multiple hits, including bankruptcy and foreclosure. On the day we were in Kansas City, the foreclosure rate was at a 65-year high. At the same time, one quarter of all mortgaged homes were underwater, which meant that the owners owed more to their lenders than their houses were actually worth. With the number 13 trillion still hanging in the air, John then turned to a slide that appeared on a giant screen. Titled, "The New Fear Economy," it showed that unemployment had risen, the real estate and stock markets had crashed, interest rates were a great big question mark, and prices for commodities, like Missouri rice and soybeans, were wandering around like a drunk walking home from a tavern. Oil had been a wild roller coaster ride, from $51 per barrel at the start of 2007 to $145 in the summer of 2008, and then down to almost $30 at the start of 2009. No one, from the homeowners trying to heat their houses to the fuel buyers for major airlines, had any idea how to plan their fuel expenses or protect themselves from sudden price shocks. Although no one needed to be told that we were in the worst economic crisis since the Great Depression, John couldn't get to the good news part of his talk without a more detailed review of recent events. As he reminded the audience, consumer spending, the driver of America's economy, had contracted in the fourth quarter of 2008 to its second lowest level on record. This kind of decline is far more important today than it would have been in the past, because our economy has become much more dependent on the consumer. Except for a blip when soldiers returned from World War II, between 1940 and 1982, consumer spending never accounted for more than 63% of the economy. Then it began to rise to the point where it now represents 73%. In raw dollars, this means we've spent an extra $1 trillion that we didn't earn every year. Why did consumer spending take over more of the economy? It happened in large measure because foreign competitors began eating into the business of our manufacturing industries, and we became a net importer of goods rather than an exporter. The Chinese accelerated this process by keeping their currency grossly undervalued, which made their goods even cheaper. America became the main consumer of the world's output, whether it was Middle Eastern oil, Korean electronics, or Chilean fruit. The transition from a production economy to a consumer economy was evident in the shuttering of factories and the rise of shopping centers. In every community of any size, big retail chains built new outlets, and they were followed by restaurants, movie theaters, tanning salons, and countless other businesses that arose along the highway to help us spend our cash. For a time, all this retail activity preserved the sense that we had a rich and vibrant economy. Rising equity and property prices, coupled with falling interest rates and financial deregulation, led to a myriad of mystical new ways to borrow money. And as lenders steadily weakened their own credit standards to sell more debt, individuals, families, and the government kept spending at an impressive pace. The result is that from 1951 to today, total corporate and consumer debt has more than doubled as a percentage of GDP. When we finally ran out of savings and credit to support the binge, the Great Recession struck. Real estate values plummeted, foreclosures skyrocketed, and millions of people were thrown out of work. The spectacle of busted banks riveted the business press. But thanks to federal supports, no depositors lost any money, and government bailouts saved the financial system. Individuals and families weren't so fortunate. Homes were abandoned, retirement accounts were ruined, and businesses struggled as more than 7 million jobs disappeared. We all understand that real pain, psychological, financial, even the physical pain of hunger, lies behind the numbers. Dr. Sam Cohen, a psychotherapist who consults with business, told us that millions of people have been genuinely traumatized by the Great Recession. Although most will eventually come out of the crisis with a renewed sense of purpose, in the short run, they are being forced to acknowledge they are powerless over certain things. It's like a cancer diagnosis that snaps people to attention and makes them reconsider what's really important in life. At the Nelson Atkins Museum, the data on lost jobs, foreclosures, and busted investments cast a pall over the auditorium. For a bit of comic relief, John noted that the recession had a few bright spots. A dentist in Manhattan had seen a 25% increase among patients with problems from grinding their teeth. The surgeon-in-chief at the Cornell Institute for Reproductive Medicine reported a 48% jump in vasectomies because couples found it cheaper than paying for contraception or new babies. And the University of Florida reported a 32% decline in shark attacks in 2009 because fewer would-be swimmers could afford to vacation at the beach. The dentists, surgeons, and sharks, who have blood and pain in common, won a bit of nervous laughter from the audience. And when John said that in light of the Great Recession, people had begun to question the very future of the capitalist system and the government's basic competence, a murmur of assent swept through the hall. Apparently, more than a few in this crowd had been sufficiently shaken by recent events to start openly challenging the leaders who had gotten us into this mess and the mindset that had allowed us to follow them. This kind of feeling was common across the political spectrum and fueled both the anti-government Tea Party rallies in Washington and the anti-bailout protests on Wall Street. When the histories of our Great Recession are written, politicians, regulators, bankers, and speculators will take the greatest share of the blame because they caused the most damage. The level of excess at the top of the power pyramid was breathtaking, as leaders of every stripe grew intoxicated with a kind of magical thinking about ever-expanding wealth. One of the few sober analysts in this period, Bill Gross of PIMCO Investments, estimated that assets were overvalued by $15 trillion during this time. Much of this illusory value was posted as collateral so people could borrow against it. Whether through ignorance, incompetence, inattention, or greed, our leaders failed so spectacularly that you might expect the population to revolt. But Americans generally resisted the urge to grab torches and pitchforks and go looking for the bad guys. Perhaps this is because we were aware, on some level, of the way almost every one of us had played a role in the debacle and could accept a measure of responsibility. Unless you were a novice with the Sisters of Charity, you almost couldn't avoid participating in the culture of acquisition that blossomed in the last three decades. In this time, Americans bought so much stuff that an entire industry, self-storage rental units, emerged just so we would have some place to put it all. Once isolated to a few operators with garage-like premises, self-storage now counts 53,000 facilities nationwide with 1.8 billion square feet of space, most of it built in the past decade and filled with goods Americans acquired during a time when we spent more than we earned. In part, this spending was encouraged by plummeting prices. But we were hardly bargain shoppers. As Newsweek's Dana Thomas reported in her 2007 book, Deluxe, between 1985 and 2005, luxury became so mainstream, Chanel sold one bottle of its number 5 perfume every 30 seconds. Whether it came from the luxe category or the shelves at Sam's Club, almost everything we bought, from Cokes at McDonald's to TV sets for our living rooms, was bigger. The average size of the American home grew from 983 square feet in 1950 to 2,349 square feet in 2006, increasing 20% each decade. Our cars increased steadily in horsepower, interior room, and what manufacturers call curb weight, which is the weight of a car when it's delivered to a customer. In 1990, the average American car weighed less than 2,900 pounds. In 2005, it weighed more than 4,000. Our beds got bigger as thicker mattresses and king sizes became more popular, and we bought so many clothes that the market for closet renovations grew 25% per year between 1996 and 2006. At first, we got the money to pay for all this excess by cutting back on savings. In something we call the 50-20 paradox, Americans had spent 50 years developing a savings habit that saw us put away more than 10% of our income up until the mid-1980s. At that point, as the consumer culture heated up, our savings rate cooled off. It took us just 20 years to reach a negative savings rate. In 2007, the national savings rate hit a 73-year low. Not surprisingly, at that moment, the press also reported that thanks to inflated real estate and stock market values, aggregate net worth exceeded $63 trillion, or roughly $500,000 per household. When we no longer had money in the bank, many of us felt we had plenty in our homes. To keep on buying, we pledged our future incomes and net worth to run up credit by using housing as an ATM. In 2007, the Kennedy Greenspan estimates of mortgage equity withdrawal, when people refinance with cash out or draw down their home equity lines of credit, was accounting for nearly 9% of Americans' disposable income. In the early 1980s, when the era of consumption began, household debt equaled just 44% of gross domestic product, a measure of the nation's total economic activity. After a 20-year climb, it exceeded 100% in 2007. No one forced us to abandon the saving habit or forged our signatures on the mortgage papers that consumed the equity that once rested comfortably in our homes. We did it all, willingly, which means, as John told the crowd in Kansas City, as consumers, all of us, in our daily lives, contributed a large part to the problem. And yet, John then said, there is the upside to the downside. In this moment of crisis, we can see the beginning of an era of social change, influenced not by government, Wall Street, or big business, but by, of all things, consumerism. Even as people find themselves less rich, they are deploying their dollars in a more calculated and strategic way to influence institutions like corporations and government. They realize that how they spend their money is a form of power, and they are using it to communicate their values and reward those companies that truly reflect them, whether they are pro-environment, anti-bailout, or concerned about some other issue. In this way, each dollar resembles a vote, and every day is election day for companies that provide goods and services. The proof of this values revolution emerges in the brand asset valuator data, which we had been crunching with the help of John's partner, Ed Labar, CEO of Brand Asset Consulting, and some independent experts, including Professors Philip Kotler at Northwestern, Kevin Keller at Dartmouth, and Natalie Mizik at Columbia Business School. Together, we had seen that despite declining economic strength, the American consumer was actually wielding greater power in the marketplace. By restraining their demand through more thoughtful spending, people were pushing businesses to deliver higher quality and more responsible behavior. In other words, they were using their ever more precious dollars to buy a better experience, a better community, even a better world. As Professor Mizik noted, this move toward more values-based spending reflects an adaptation to a life event that has been shared across society. When a great number of people experience a crisis of this magnitude, needs replace wants, and consumerism becomes not just thrifty, but strategic. Looking at the global economy and the lingering effects of the recession, Mizik wondered if the crisis was really over. Her uncertainty, which was widely felt, suggested that the spend shift we had observed would only intensify. expressed by people at every point in the political spectrum and in every part of the country. The values we saw emerging even before the official start of the recession could be grouped in five categories. Indestructible spirit. Optimistic and resilient people are leveraging hardship into opportunity. Retooling. Fiercely self-reliant, we retain our faith in our core traditions and actively seek to better our communities and ourselves. Liquid life. We are adopting a more nimble, adaptable, and thrifty approach to life. Cooperative consumerism. Crisis has prompted people to collaborate to solve problems and create new options. From materialism to the material. Old status symbols no longer appeal as purpose, character, authenticity, and creativity become pathways to the new good life. The surge in positive values actually began to appear in our data almost 20 years ago. In the early 1990s, brand asset valuators showed that people were becoming much savvier about the advertising techniques used to sell them things, and they began to feel a healthy skepticism about the value of marketing claims. Some even began developing arguments to counter the rampant consumerism that swept the country. In Seattle, public television station KCTS and filmmaker John DeGraff produced a rather disturbing documentary, Affluenza, that warned of the economic, social, and psychological effects of overheated consumerism. In Tennessee, a devout Christian named Dave Ramsey challenged the popular prosperity gospel offered by preachers who equated wealth with God's grace. At churches and then over the radio airwaves, Ramsey advocated Christian thrift and responsibility. Ramsey's first book, Financial Peace, taught readers how to find contentment by curbing debt and living simply. At his public appearances, he made a big impression by welcoming members of the audience to share their stories and then invited them to cut up their credit cards on the spot. Many did. He called this procedure a plastectomy. While a few thinkers and commentators rallied people to resist material excess, millions of people turned to the internet to become more intelligent economic agents. Through sites like Yelp, TripAdvisor, and Zillow, they studied product ratings and scoured the marketplace for the best deals. For the first time in history, people around the world were empowered to trade information on products and services instantaneously. One of the clearest examples of this phenomenon is the way fans texted instant reviews that panned the movie Bruno the weekend it was released. The movie moguls had a new term for it, the death by Twitter effect. The intelligence and assertiveness we saw developing prior to the Great Recession meant that consumers could shop for lasting quality and seek out goods and services from suppliers who matched their sense of ethics. They could and did move from mindless consumption to mindful consumption, taking care to purchase goods and services only from sellers who met their standards. They could also use the internet to create groups of consumers who could exercise even greater power. This desire to use money to express values stands out in our brand asset valuator data and was expressed by many of the people who participated in a series of digital town halls we conducted to gain insight into the mindset and motivations of post-crisis consumer behavior. Together, they reveal that a majority of Americans already say they have changed their lifestyles and the way they behave in the marketplace. This great shift in how people spend their time, energy, and money is a societal response to the Great Recession. Awakened by the economic crisis, people are returning to old-fashioned values: optimism, self-reliance, practicality, hard work, thrift, community, honesty, kindness, and they are applying these ideals in their relationship and their careers, and in their consumption habits as well. Who are the spend shifters? Well, they aren't radical frugalists, Christian ascetics, or extreme New Age anti-materialists. They are merely people who, in adapting to crisis, have subtly adjusted their lives to seek greater balance and a more fulfilling existence. According to our data, 55% of all Americans are fully part of this undeclared movement. In addition, about one quarter of the U.S. adult population expresses many of the same attitudes and characteristics. Call them fast followers. The spend shift encompasses people from all walks of life. It is blind to age, education, income, political affiliation, and geography. Millennials, the generation born between 1980 and 1998, lead the movement, yet nearly half of all senior citizens belong too. They are both highly educated and not, with 21% college educated and 23% having a high school degree or less. They are rich and poor and equally represent Republicans, Democrats, and Independents, 28%, 31%, and 41% each. This values-led movement embraces people from all across the nation as well. 17% are from the Northeast, 23% are from the Midwest, 36% are from the South, and 24% are from the West. And lest we think this movement is purely an American one, we examined country data in Brand Asset Valuator and found spend shifters emerging around the world. This was a global crisis, after all. Interestingly, there are fewer spend shifters in fast-growing economies like China and India and the Czech Republic, where consumerism is still emerging. What unites the shifters is a common sense of optimism and newfound purpose. They are living with less and yet feeling greater happiness and satisfaction. 78% report they are happier with a more down-to-basics lifestyle. 88% report that they buy less expensive brands than they used to. And nearly the same number report that possessions do not have much to do with how happy they are. The irony of people feeling happier even though they are less wealthy and more constrained by the economy is easier to explain than you might expect. When we looked back at the data, we saw that a great many people never were all that comfortable with the overheated consumer economy. Keeping up with the Joneses can be a physically and spiritually draining pursuit, and many who participated felt a nagging sense of unhappiness, as if with every trip to a big box store they were betraying some higher value. We heard many expressions of this concern about higher values and consumer behavior in the digital town halls we conducted to talk about these ideas. Sweet Mom, the online username of a 45-year-old woman from Seattle, said, "I believe and hope that today's economic crisis will have taught all of us a lesson. I was raised that you didn't buy something unless you had the money for it. Credit cards were okay if you paid them off monthly. That seems to be old-school thinking, but it was the right thinking." Another digital town hall participant called Dancing Diva, who was 28 and from Salt Lake City, said, "The recession has been a true eye-opener for me. I have had to say no to things that I ended up not missing after all. The recession has helped me to really distinguish between needs and wants." Like Dancing Diva, 78% of all the people we surveyed find it off-putting when people show off expensive purchases. But this sentiment is even stronger among people who earn $100,000 a year or more. Similarly, people aged 50 to 64 and the generation that is between 18 and 24 share the same aversion to status brands and the same interest in doing things for themselves. Young adults are more comfortable than all the others when it comes to reordering priorities and adapting. Fully 77% of them, compared with 66% overall, said they realize they are actually happier with a simpler, more down-to-basics lifestyle. They identify strongly with their grandparents, members of what's called the greatest generation, the ones who survived the Great Depression and won World War II, who were, of necessity, experts in self-sufficiency and sustainability. They didn't use those terms, of course. Instead, they just went about growing their own food, reducing their consumption of expensive energy, and making everything they owned last longer through upkeep and repair. Like the greatest generation, millennials want to learn more skills, take responsibility for their own well-being, and tackle problems and projects on their own. They pursue life with the feeling that they lost little by way of financial and material wealth in the recession, so this leaves them free to take risks. Were you laid off in Cleveland? Go buy a $500 building in downtown Detroit and start a business. Did your manufacturing job get shipped overseas? Go back to school and become a nurse. When you have a flexible, nimble approach to life, you refuse to be defeated by temporary setbacks, and you willingly take risks in order to take advantage of new opportunities. In fact, 88% of young adults state they believe that their own imagination is the key to the future. The data also shows that across society, people don't just feel empowered as individuals. They feel inspired about their ability to band together to influence big institutions like corporations and to improve their communities. On Main Street, where people don't get bonuses and bailouts, values-led consumerism offers not only economic but democratic clout. Overanalytical Susie, a 26-year-old from Philadelphia, put it this way. I think the power of the penny is one of the greatest powers there is. I think that if more people realized how much their dollars affected companies and policies, they would, 1, act with more urgency to change things, 2, feel more powerful, and 3, be more responsible about how they spend their money. Nearly 2/3 of all the people who responded to the Brand Asset Valuator feel they can affect corporate behavior through their purchasing habits, with the same amount avoiding companies whose values contradict their own. 3/4 of these conscious consumers are aligning their spending with their values to support responsible companies. For example, Mama Bear, a 35-year-old from Iowa City, said, I know that if they have similar values to mine, then I would be more apt to purchase products from them. And January, a 23-year-old from Seattle, said, There are many other areas in a budget where Americans can cut back, but conscious consumerism should not be one of them. As John told the crowd in Kansas City, now, by restricting their demand, consumers can actually align their values with their spending and force capitalism and business to not be just about more, but about better. With those last words about how people would push business to be better in every sense of the word, the audience started to applaud. It was that kind of spontaneous reaction that comes when you have connected with something people know is true but haven't been able to articulate themselves. We took it as yet another signal that at the grassroots, people are well ahead of the pundits, corporations, and political leaders. In fact, they, really we, began to make adjustments long before anyone had even begun to talk about meltdowns, bailouts, and foreclosure rescue schemes. We compare this to the widely observed phenomenon of animals racing for safety well before human beings even notice that an earthquake or tidal wave is about to hit. Something deep inside of us knew we were on the wrong path, and we didn't need to be told to seek a better direction. Some of the most important numbers supporting this trend come from the U.S. Bureau of Economic Analysis reports on personal savings. The reports show that soon after savings rates bottomed out in 2005, something told us to start squirreling away a bit more money, and most of us listened. Ordinary Americans began raising their deposits in savings accounts and other secure investments a full 2 years before the start of the recession. Even as unemployment surged past 10% and almost matched the worst level since World War II, 10.8% in December 1982, we socked away more money every month. By the middle of 2009, as the press brought us gloomy stories of layoffs and foreclosures, we were saving about 7% of our disposable income, a figure that hadn't been seen since 1995. The big federal data banks also tell us that people cut back on spending, in all areas, many months before the recession began. In fact, we reduced our consumption so sharply that in the middle of 2008, it dropped below our disposable income and just kept falling. This discipline wasn't a short-lived fad. As the months passed, we maintained a positive balance of income and spending throughout all of 2009. For many months, the net surplus, when you compare disposable income with what we actually spent, was greater than we had seen in 20 years. Without being scolded, lectured, or led from above, Americans had quietly shifted their behavior. We detect early signals of a values renaissance in our data as far back as the early 1990s. It appears when we study, for lack of a better term, the materialistic desires of the typical American. In response to questions about how they preferred to spend their money, people expressed steadily declining interest in objects of desire, fancy cars, flashy jewelry, trendy clothes, and a stronger attachment to products and services that meet their needs reliably, day in and day out. It's clear that people were editing want from need well before the recession began. Perhaps on some level, people were becoming truly uncomfortable with their own excess. The Pew Center, too, reported that in 2009, the majority of Americans no longer considered TVs, dishwashers, dryers, and air conditioning to be necessities. In the report, What Americans Need, it found that these items had become luxuries, according to more people in its national survey. Along with provocative data related to how people vote with their dollars, our brand asset valuator surveys also gave us a revealing portrait of the human qualities people prefer to meet as they explore the marketplace. People still participated in the economy, and they even gave themselves treats like travel and restaurant meals. Christmas presents and Valentine's Day chocolates never went out of style. But between 2005 and 2009, we saw some remarkable shifts as people rejected snobbishness and exclusivity, and embraced attributes that bring people closer together or suggest a commitment to making our world a better place. Among the once prized attributes that declined in this period were exclusive, down 60%, arrogant, down 41%, sensuous, down 30%, daring, down 20%, trendy, down 13%. On the opposite side of the scale, the attributes Americans found more important as they began to sense the impending recession and then suffered through the crisis were kindness and empathy, up 391%, friendly, up 148%, high quality, up 124%, socially responsible, up 63%, leader, up 40%. The increase reported for kindness is not a typo. Between 2005 and 2009, American consumers expressed a nearly fourfold increase in their preference for companies that show kindness in both their operations and their encounters with customers. This desire for companies to be more empathetic in how they treat customers is the biggest shift in any attitude that we have ever seen during the 17-year life of the Brand Asset Valuator Survey. Altogether, the numbers we draw from Young and Rubicam's ongoing Brand Asset Valuator Survey and from the more generally available economic data that flows from government, academic, and business sources paint a surprisingly bright picture of both the present and the future. Yes, the Great Recession has destroyed millions of jobs and trillions of dollars in wealth, and it has been a huge financial setback for countless Americans. But when you look beneath the surface, you see that everyday Americans are resilient, sensible, and sturdy. A few social commentators have seen evidence of these strengths in declining crime rates, rising interest in public libraries. 68% of Americans have library cards, the highest ever. And a recent burst of volunteerism led, remarkably, by people who have lost their jobs. The Great Recession's hidden virtues, as writer Michael Gerson called them, mirror the nation's experience during the Great Depression, when families and communities watched out for each other and many indicators of social well-being, including crime rates, voter turnout, and participation in social groups like bowling leagues, scouting, and 4-H, all improved. Many Americans who struggled through the Depression adopted a set of moral and economic habits as thrift, family commitment, savings, and modest consumption that lasted through their lifetimes and that have decayed in our own, wrote Gerson. The Depression generation controlled the things it could control, including its own consumption and character. The same thing seems to be happening now, as the shock of our economic loss wears off and people try to redefine what it means to be successful and happy. In early 2010, the New York Times reported on polls that showed people are spending more time doing things with friends and family and enjoying hobbies like gardening and baking. Our interest in low-cost shared experiences, museum visits, picnics, and movies, seems to be rising as our interest in shopping declines. According to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, we are also putting more time into community service and religious and spiritual activities. We see obvious implications for businesses in the numbers that John shared with the audience in Kansas City. Americans are demanding more of the people they trade with, and this includes using their dollars to influence them to do good as they are doing well. You can't fight and control this, said John. Companies will need to find different ways to offer an exchange of value with consumers. Then he flashed another slide on the screen. It was a quote from Andy Grove, one of the founders of Intel. It read, "Bad companies are destroyed by crises. Good companies survive them. Great companies are improved by them." The crisis that exists today is real, allowed John. But it is also a tremendous opportunity for those who can see where the economy is headed. I'm convinced we're entering an era where values now define consumerism. The demand that built the largest consumer economy in the world will now prefer better instead of more. With a clearer understanding of their necessities, consumers can reconstruct capitalism to be creative rather than destructive, to bring greater value to the world we live in, and offer us the opportunity to connect with companies that share our beliefs. We see a very hopeful picture for the future of America. It wasn't a highly dramatic ending. We didn't post an image of Old Glory on the screen and cue a Sousa march. Nevertheless, the crowd burst into applause. Afterward, we were met by a long line of people who shared their own stories of shifting values, and the satisfaction that comes with surviving a crisis. The most poignant one came from a middle-aged woman who lived in a comfortable suburb where many of the men, in their 40s and 50s, have been laid off by companies that aren't likely to ever ask them to come back. After a bit of grieving, these men have come together to support each other in the struggle with unemployment. To keep their spirits up, they began organizing block parties, something they had never done before, and found a wealth of friendship to replace the material wealth they had lost. Others in Kansas City said that they had tired of the consumer juggernaut many years ago and welcomed the prospect of living in a world where character and values mattered more than the size of your car or house. They were actually excited about changes that, until this moment, had made them more anxious than optimistic, more fearful than hopeful. However, they wanted to know if we had deep, first-hand experience with the type of consumers we were describing, earnest, demanding, humane, and contact with companies that were adapting and prepared to succeed in the post-crisis economy of less frenzied buying and selling. Standing with those show-me people from Missouri, we realized that while we believed in the research and in the inevitability of the change that was underway, we didn't have enough on-the-ground evidence to have the whole story. In that moment, we realized that something very exciting was going on out there and decided to devote as much time as was required to find and document it. In the months that followed, we traveled to dozens of communities in 8 states, both red and blue, to study the spend shift and discover how people intend to live in the post-recession age. We talked with people across kitchen counters, in restaurants, on street corners, in factories, and in boardrooms. We shopped with people in supermarkets and big box stores. We watched people network at job fairs. We walked the floors of startup companies. We interrogated small business owners. And we observed how Fortune 500 CEOs were adjusting their business models. What we learned both affirmed and amplified the trends suggested by the data. A values revolution is reshaping the consumer marketplace. American companies, regardless of their size or their target market, must understand the significance of this social trend. Those who grasp it and adapt will find extraordinary opportunities. Those who ignore it will do so at their peril. Chapter 1. The New American Frontier, Detroit, Michigan. At sunrise on the first Friday in December, a film crew from a European television network blocks the oak-paneled entry hall at the Inn on Ferry Street in Detroit with a pile of black equipment bags that hold tripods, lights, and boom microphones. While somewhat annoyed, fellow guests squeeze around them to reach their morning coffee, which waits in the parlor of the elegantly restored Victorian house, the TV folks talk excitedly about the great images they shot and the powerful interviews they conducted. After a week in pursuit of America in decline, as one of the crew describes their mission, they had captured the shocking story of Detroit circa 2010 and were heading home like big game hunters with their trophies. Were there actually antelope heads in those bags? No one would believe this was the story of the Motor City, he says. But it's a disaster, and we have the pictures. Outside, a horn announces the arrival of the van that will take the crew, just the latest of many who have come to chronicle the city's demise, to the airport. As one of the technicians struggles to get the bulky equipment bags outside, he complains about the chill. A cold front had swept through overnight, but smiles to signal that he was happy to be leaving with his mission accomplished. The story that the film crew bagged was the easiest economy in crisis piece any journalist could pursue in 2009, long in economic retreat, Detroit had been further savaged by the Great Recession that started at the end of 2007. The median home price had dropped from an already low $60,000 in August 2005 to below $8,000. Commercial real estate had seen an even more precipitous decline, as evidenced by the recent sale of the 80,000-seat Silverdome Stadium in nearby Pontiac for $583,000, roughly the equivalent of a studio apartment in Manhattan. Local unemployment, thanks mainly to the troubles of the automakers, was estimated at 28.9%, not counting those who had given up looking, compared with 10.2% nationwide. Desperate for work, many Detroiters had fled. The city's population, which had peaked at 1.8 million in 1950, was estimated to be less than 900,000. Far more compelling than the statistics was the city's landscape. Abandoned factories, vacant commercial buildings, and neighborhoods where three-quarters of the homes have been boarded, burned, or bulldozed. In the most desolate residential areas, you could drive for blocks and see few signs of life except for stray dogs and occasionally a coyote. Some of the houses had been abandoned for so long that small trees and vines have grown to cover entire walls. Detroit's poignant decay has become a favorite subject of photographers who always seem to make special note of decrepit landmarks. The Michigan Theater Building, where cars now park beneath the ornate lobby arches, and the hollowed-out Michigan Central Railroad Depot. Once one of the great railroad stations in the country, the 18-story building is now gutted and barricaded behind a security fence that couldn't keep thieves from tearing the copper wire, pipes, and anything else of value out of the building. It looms over the west side like some science fiction monster. Given the apocalyptic panorama, any first-time visitor who landed in Detroit in late 2009 and drove around the city for the first time would half expect to see marauding Mad Max figures come roaring down the street on handmade battle wagons powered by Allison diesel engines. The decay and loss were writ large across the city, and you didn't need a TV cameraman's eye to see it. But if you looked more closely, you could find something that most outsiders miss. A Detroit that is vibrant, creative, and optimistic. On the same morning when the foreign journalists were departing from the inn on Ferry Street, more about the inn later, a bunch of regulars were crowding into a cafe that serves as a little oasis of comfort just a few miles away, in the heart of the crumbling city. This is the part of the Detroit story most visiting journalists never see or acknowledge. It is a thriving business in a place that others consider a wasteland, and it represents an indestructible human spirit that arose in the very depths of the Great Recession in the place that was hit hardest of all. It was also the first stop in a remarkable adventure that revealed that a hard luck city could also be a modern frontier of opportunity. Le Petit Zinc occupies a small lot on the corner of Trumbull and Howard Streets in a downtown neighborhood dominated by machine shops, a drug rehabilitation center, halfway houses, and riverfront warehouses. The building itself is a nondescript, single-story rectangle faced in the kind of dusty yellow brick that was used to build countless elementary schools in the 1950s. In fact, it was last used as a preschool and daycare center, and proprietor Charles Sorrell has made good use of the chain-link fence that once surrounded the playground. He has created a secure parking lot, which is great for business in a place where the center city has emptied out and walking is no longer practical. In the sheltered yard near the door, he installed an herb and vegetable garden complete with a bubbling fountain and outdoor seating. An artist as well as an entrepreneur, Sorrell painted the sign out front, which features the jaunty rooster that is a symbol of the French spirit. He also designed the cafe's interior, which welcomes customers with warm yellows and bright blues that echo the Côte d'Azur. On this windswept Friday, Sorrell arose before 5 o'clock so he could enjoy a shower and a cup of tea before getting to his shop at 6. There he was joined by a cook named Molly Motor, her real name, and server named Rachel Harkai. Within minutes, the hot stove and coffee machines filled the place with the aromas of breakfast and coated the cold windows with condensation. Sorrell's first patron was a local judge who enjoys the quiet and the quality of the croissants, baguettes, and espresso. By 8 o'clock, Le Petit Zinc, French slang for the local bar, bustles with a crowd of regulars and a handful of first-timers. Thanks to word of mouth and a few good reviews, the bistro now draws travelers and explorers from the suburbs. After the morning rush, 48-year-old Sorel takes a break at one of his handmade tables. Born in Martinique but raised in France, he's a lanky fellow who traces his ancestors to both Europe and Africa, and he speaks somewhat fractured English in a lilting accent. His curly black hair is flecked with silver and not completely tamed. The wild style gives him the look of an excited, energetic man on the move, which is exactly what he is. Resourceful, unflagging, and relentlessly optimistic, he is the kind of immigrant who has always helped fuel the American economy with energy and a zest for life. The death of Sorel's father-in-law, his wife Karima is from Detroit, brought him to the city where, like most newcomers, he was taken aback by the conditions. But he had succeeded once with a cafe in Brooklyn, his first home when he came to America in 1989, and decided to stay and try again. "We have to live," he said in a puzzled reply to a question about why he might open a French bistro in a neighborhood where it's hard to find even a good hamburger. "I have to feed my family, and I had no other qualifications here." In fact, a welcoming little eatery, something like a family kitchen where the coffee pot is always on, makes for the perfect startup business in any community, especially one that is short of comforts. The ultimate social animals, human beings naturally seek each other, and from farm communities in the West to big city neighborhoods, cafes serve as gathering spots. Sorel recalled the places in Paris that made him feel good and set about creating one. He started by focusing on the food. Detroit didn't have a nice French-style bistro with real Parisian coffee and authentic cuisine, he says, adding, "People like quality." Then he mentions the staff. In a depressed employment market, he was able to hire what may be the most motivated, educated, and experienced cafe staff anywhere. Every person on the team is devoted to making both the cuisine they serve and their service so professional. Unsatisfied with his own answers, Sorel pauses and looks around at the crowded tables. He cocks his ear to hear the warm din of conversation punctuated by the clatter of dishes and silverware. A smile comes over his face as he realizes that the secret of his success is even more basic than good food and service. "To succeed," he says, "you need to cheer people up." Good cheer, we have optimism all the time, is at the emotional heart of Sorel's business. But it is not the only inspirational element of his business plan. From the moment he began to plan the cafe, he set down some operating principles that would communicate certain values to his staff and his customers. First, the books would be completely open to everyone who works at the bistro, so they could see how the business was doing, month to month. Second, work would not be rigidly assigned. At any moment, you might wait tables, wash dishes, or prepare food or drinks, which meant work was never boring. Third, all the workers, including the founder, would draw the same pay. This policy means that everyone had good reason to provide the highest quality at the lowest price in order to build the business. It also meant that they must find some satisfaction in rewards beyond cash.
Passing behind the boss.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.